morning. Can I welcome everyone to the 17th meeting in 2015 of the Infrastructure and Capital Investment Committee? Can I remind everyone present to switch off mobile phones as they do affect the broadcasting system? As meeting papers are provided in digital format, you may see tablets being used during the meeting. No apologies have been received for this meeting, but Siobhan McMahon has been delayed, and we will defer agenda item 1, declaration of interests, until later in the meeting with the agreement of colleagues.
Agreed.
And also, sorry, my apologies, I'm just being reminded that Dave Stewart has in fact submitted his apologies and will not be with us this morning. Agenda item 2 is a decision on taking business in private. Can I ask the committee to agree to take agenda item 4, consideration of the committee's work programme in private? Are we agreed? Thank you. Agenda item 3 is for the committee to take oral evidence from the Deputy First Minister and Cabinet Secretary for Finance, Constitution and Economy on digital infrastructure and participation. Can I welcome John Swinney, the Deputy First Minister and Cabinet Secretary for Finance, Constitution and Economy, Trudy Nicolson, Head of Broadband Policy, and Duncan Nisbet, Senior Stakeholder Manager at the Scottish Government. Good morning. And can I invite the Deputy First Minister to make an opening statement?
Thank you, Convener. I welcome this opportunity to update the committee on our preparations to deliver high-quality digital connectivity, which is a major priority for the Scottish Government. This underpins our economic strategy, helping our businesses reach new markets and ensuring that people can work flexibly. Amongst the many benefits we are seeing, helping to reverse depopulation is amongst the most important for rural Scotland. The impact of our £410 million Digital Scotland Superfast Broadband Investment Programme is being felt right across Scotland. Over 390,000 homes and businesses across Scotland now have fibre services available to them as a result of our investment. And on average, the programme is connecting 7,000 new homes and businesses every week. Early take-up has been strong, and as a result of this, the contracts have generated a gain-share return of around £18 million, new funding that can be used to further extend the reach of the project. This investment is having a transformational impact as it connects premises across Scotland, but I recognise and share the frustration of communities that don't yet know when or if the programme will reach them. We are taking steps to address this. BT is about to start modelling the gainshare funds, which will push the DSSB programme even further, but will also make clearer where it won't go. That will allow Community Broadband Scotland to proactively work with those communities to develop alternative solutions. I'm determined that communities who are ultimately not included in the Digital Scotland programme are not left as an afterthought. Community Broadband Scotland has a critical role to play. It is already working with 89 communities comprising more than 16,000 premises to help them develop plans for faster broadband. Earlier this year, CBS provided almost £1 million to a group of island communities in Argyll for a project which saw AB Internet contracted to deliver superfast broadband to over 1,400 homes and businesses. This is a fantastic project, an innovative technology solution, an alternative supplier, a community-owned asset, and superfast broadband for some of the most challenging remote rural premises in the country. It is a great example of what CBS can do. Similar projects in Fife and Skye will start procurement in the coming weeks. We recently announced funding of £9 million under the 2014 to 2020 Scottish Rural Development Programme to support this type of project. That more than doubles our investment in community broadband and should help communities across Scotland follow the lead of the Giga Plus Argyll. We're also looking at options for a second phase of superfast broadband investment. £21 million has been made available by the UK Government, which the Scottish Government has agreed to match fund. One option is to extend the current Digital Scotland contracts, and the modelling that BT is about to start will help to demonstrate potential impacts. But BT will not only need to demonstrate value for money, they will need to fully complete their commercial rollout as planned and demonstrate a continued willingness to invest alongside the public sector going forward. There are other aspects to the whole issue of connectivity, issues around mobile connectivity, where we have seen an innovative project delivered on the island of Col in partnership with Vodafone, where we brought 4G services to the island using a community-owned mast, which has demonstrated the impact that mobile coverage can have on remote communities. We are also focused on improving digital participation and on ensuring that the digital economy is well served by the investments that we make on skills and development support to ensure that we reap the full economic benefits of the investment in superfast broadband. We should not underestimate the progress that has been made over the past year. The benefits of our substantial investment across the digital agenda are being felt, but there is more to do, and the Government is focused on ensuring that we equip Scotland with the digital connectivity to ensure that we can meet the needs and the aspirations of people in Scotland.
Thank you very much, Deputy First Minister. You mentioned the progress that is being made in rolling out Digital Scotland Superfast Broadband Programme. I understand that alongside the commercial rollout of fibre broadband, the programme is intended to extend access to fibre broadband to 85% of premises by 2015-16 and at least 95% of premises, which equates to 750,000 homes and businesses across Scotland by 2017-18. Are these targets still on target to be met?
Yes, they are, and the progress that has been made in the rollout of superfast broadband gives us confidence that we are on track to achieve these targets. There is, of course, as the committee will be aware, an important interrelationship at the heart of the contracts, which is about putting in place the necessary confidence of support for the investment programme that has been agreed, but also trying to secure even greater digital connectivity as a consequence beyond the 85 and 95% targets. So I would be, certainly one of my perspectives in managing this contract is to ensure that we have the right monitoring framework in place to stretch those 85 and 95% targets with the ambition of exceeding them if we possibly can do.
Okay. I mean, clearly, by definition, if we're meeting a target of 85% or 95%, we're therefore not meeting the ambition to extend access to every home in Scotland. There will be homes and businesses that are excluded, that are subject to what is referred to as digital exclusion. So what more can the government do to address that?
Well, essentially, this is a... I suppose this is the moving feast that is at the heart of this this process. I want to be clear with the committee that I do not support, and the government is not prepared to countenance, digital exclusion. We have a commitment to work to ensure that every individual in Scotland, every business, is able to secure digital connectivity of the quality that is envisaged in this programme. The challenge for us is about how to deliver that within a commercial contract where if the government had not intervened in all of this, commercial coverage would have reached about 66%. So we would have had a yawning gulf of connectivity within the country. So the government's intervention has improved the position from 66% to what will be 95% by the end of 2017. But we can't leave it there, and I want to be crystal clear with the committee that the government is focused on ensuring that the remaining 5% are able to be connected and have access to this technology. Some of that, so if we focus on that 5%, some of that I hope will be eroded by the measures such as the gain share announcement that I referred to earlier on, whereby the management of the contract and the rollout of this programme has actually ensured that there will be greater access to superfast broadband than had been envisaged before. That's the first point. The second is that, of course, we have a range of different interventions in place to try to further erode that 5%, working through Community Broadband Scotland, part of the objective of Community Broadband Scotland is to find solutions for some of these hard-to-reach areas, and the Giga Plus Argyle example is just one of the projects that CBS are working on. So what makes all of that work slightly more complicated is the fact that it's not absolutely clear where the 5% are going to be. And that is something that we work with communities to identify and work with BT to clarify, because obviously we are prevented from putting in place what I might call a CBS solution if BT commercially or through the Digital Scotland Superfast Broadband Programme are actually going to get there and make that provision. So I appreciate that is not an absolutely definitive clarity for individual communities. Now, I quite understand the frustration there is in different communities that they can't quite get a definitive answer as to whether the commercial programme is going to get to them or not going to get to them. But we are working very closely with BT to try to establish the parameters of that challenge and see how we can deliver that as effective as we can.
Okay. Thank you for that. You mentioned in your opening statement the substantial investment which has already been made and which will continue to be made by the government in pursuing its ambitions to roll out digital connectivity across the country. Is it envisaged that there will be further financial investment necessary to achieve further progress?
I think that will be the case, Convener, yes. I think the investment that's been made just now is aimed to deliver 95% access by the end of 2017. As I've said already, I am optimistic that that investment will raise that level beyond 95% simply by the way in which, with good working practices, with the removal of obstacles, with a whole variety of different, with improvements in level of digital participation, which we are seeing, that as a consequence of all of these different measures and interventions, that 95% will rise. But the amount of money we invest will not need to rise to deliver that. However, there will still be a proportion that requires further investment, and I think that will require more money than we have already committed to CBS and to the Scottish Rural Development Programme.
Okay, and when will you be in a position to update the committee on the actual
That feels to me to be some time off, convener, as to when. I'm satisfied that between the CBS resources available and the SRDP resources available and the competitive pressure I'm applying on the contract to secure an increase in the 95% connection level, that there are enough stretching factors within the contractual arrangement to keep the pressure on to maximise the value that we achieve for the investment that we're making. And it's only after I've seen the performance of all of those interventions will I make a further judgment about additional resources. And that doesn't feel to me as if that is something that will be done within the next 12 months.
So it may not even be yourself that's taking that decision.
But who knows how long I'll be here for?
I'm sure that your longevity as a politician is something that can be assured, if nothing else. Adam, you had a supplementary on that point.
Yes. Morning, Deputy First Minister. Couple of questions. One was on the gain share issue that you discussed. Clearly, BT are the major, the major people who are actually putting the infrastructure in, and possibly even benefiting from the broadband connections through their services. Can we not be doing a little bit more in terms of squeezing, as you say, more value out of the contracts, given that BT seem to be in a position to gain quite a lot over time from the connecting up of Scotland?
Yes, I think we can do, and I want to assure the committee that is uppermost in the contract management approach that that we take as a government. I do not see the 18 million gain share as the last gain share we will get. I think there will be further. I think there will be.
Explain a wee bit what this gain share is.
Well, essentially,
about.
It's driven by the increase in the higher than modelled take-up rate, there's a modelled take-up rate of superfast broadband, which essentially underpins the justification of the investment of public funds in this project. And where that is exceeded, we obtain a gain share. So we essentially get a payback because if, for example, we said, let's, for argument's sake, said that there were, we thought 10% of the population were going to connect to superfast broadband, and it turns out to be 15%. Well, that's a pretty substantial difference of 15% versus 10%. So that is what drives the gain share. There will also be efficiencies to be secured the more we roll out this contract, because lessons will be learnt about the way in which the services and the fibre can be most effectively deployed, and that also flows into the management of the contract, into the bargain. Now, we exercise very regular and robust management of these contractual arrangements. We do that to ensure that the investment that we are making from the public purse is able to be maximised to give us the greatest coverage possible and the greatest impact possible. And that's why in my answer to the convener earlier on, I was making the point that it's not immediately clear to me how much more money I would have to put in to close the final gap. Because if I can use the £410 million that we have committed to get that 95% up to 96, 97 or 98%, then clearly I've stretched the value of this investment and I've minimised the call for additional resource that may well be required to ensure that everybody has access to this to digital connectivity as a consequence. So there's a complex interrelationship at the heart of this contract, but I would want to make it to assure the committee of the attention the government, the focus the government has on making sure that the maximum value is realised for the investment that we've made.
Because on the face of it, BT seems to dominate the market, and there's arguably competition is at a premium. So it falls to the government, does it not, to ensure the value for money for the taxpayer is really maximised.
I entirely agree with Mr. Ingram's points. I think this is exactly the approach we're taking on the management of this contract. I think there are wider regulatory issues here. I think there's, obviously they're out with the legislative competence of the Scottish Government, but, I think the regulatory framework around the rollout of broadband or the provision of broadband is not fit for purpose. There's a universal service obligation on BT to provide telephony services to every household in the country. That was put in, I don't know when that was put in place, I don't know when it was, let's say it was put in place in the 1960s. Well, we're in a completely different world. We're in a completely different world today to the one we were in 15 years ago in terms of digital connectivity. And the regulatory framework has not caught up with that and does not have the necessary obligation on BT to provide the type of connectivity that members of the public should expect in the 21st century, just like they were able to expect in the 1960s or 70s, whenever the USO came in for telephony services. And I think that needs to be addressed. Now, there are ways to get around that in the short term. Obviously, I'm having a very regular dialogue, very productive dialogue, I'd have to say, with the board of Ofcom. I've met the chief executive of Ofcom, Sharon White, on two occasions now to stress much of that point, that I do think in the absence of a regulatory framework that puts a universal service obligation on BT, I'm looking to Ofcom to really exercise the type of obligation and regulatory pressure on BT to make sure that the type of ambitions that Mr Ingram has quite understandably set out to the committee today are actually fulfilled. And I'm actually seeing the Ofcom board, I think it must be next week, I think I'm seeing the Ofcom board in Edinburgh, and I very much welcome the interest they're taking in the discussion and the provision in Scotland, and I look forward to that discussion with the board.
Thank you. Can I ask you finally, Deputy First Minister, has the Scottish Government submitted its final intervention area proposals to Broadband Delivery UK, BDUK?
No, we've not. That work is being modelled at the present time, and I would expect that modelling work will follow on from the modelling work that is done on what to do with the gain share resources, and once that is completed, that will be submitted to BDUK, and I would envisage that would be done before the end of the year.
Okay, thank you. Alec, you have some questions.
Thank you very much. And before we leave the issue of connectivity, I've mentioned previously to previous ministers that I live in a town where we got fibre broadband in a blaze of publicity a few years ago, but I can't get it because I'm on connected directly to the exchange. And in spite of the fact that the now First Minister suggested last year I was being singled out for that treatment, which I don't believe, can you tell me how widespread a problem is that in our town centres?
I don't think I've got a definitive figure on the extent of that issue, but certainly I know from my own constituency experience that it is a not uncommon problem. So if it helps to address Mr Johnson's panel...
Indeed, the question I was going to ask is, where does that problem or the solution to that problem figure within the grand scheme?
It's an issue that has to be remedied as far as possible within the parameters of the 95% connectivity that I talked about before. So, you know, the solution to many of these questions, and you know, I have a certain amount of technical understanding of all these processes, but the committee will forgive me if I don't get too much into the technical details. But you know, there's one particular village in my own constituency that I can think of where essentially there's a three-part rollout of supervised broadband. Two-thirds of it involves the placing of two cabinets in the village. One-third of it is people who are in exchange-only lines. And that is a more time-consuming issue to solve. Some of it may be solved by the provision of infrastructure that intervenes to address that point. But that is what essentially occupies the time and the challenge in the rollout of supervised broadband to a lot of localities. There have been more than 70,000 exchange-only lines that have been activated or enabled for supervised broadband already as part of the programme. So it's not a peripheral problem, and it's also had a pretty substantial response. But obviously that number I would expect to grow as the contract rolls out yet further.
Mm-hmm. Now, moving on to the subject of connection speeds, what average broadband speed does the Scottish Government want premises in Scotland to be able to have access to?
The average speed the target speed is a 24 megabytes per second, although the vast majority of the connections that have been made so far are receiving speeds of between 50 and 100.
Are we in danger of getting to that old situation where the way to achieve the average is to push speeds higher and higher in the areas that it's easy to achieve and ignore the areas on the periphery where it's difficult to achieve higher speeds?
Yes, but I think the objective of our programme is to deliver the maximum speed we can, although there will by necessity be challenges in the delivery of speed the further lines are away or properties are away from exchanges, and there'll be natural technological challenges at that level.
What's actually being done at the moment to raise the speeds that are below the average?
What we're trying to do is to maximise the effectiveness of the programme, and we've essentially got 91% of premises are receiving at least 24 megabytes, and of those, 69% are getting speeds above 50. Now, the challenge will be what technical measures can be taken to try to deliver higher speeds for those below 24. Obviously, the priority for the programme is to try to get people into some sphere of supervised broadband. Supervised broadband is only defined by 24 megabits per second. So we're working with our partners to try to deliver that level of connectivity, and of course there will be significant improvements on existing speeds as a consequence of the rollout of this programme. So although people may not get 24, they will be getting significantly better speeds than they're getting today.
The last question I have written down here is probably not a fair question, but the question is, when will the target be reached? But is it a target we will ever reach, or will the target keep moving?
Which particular target?
In terms of speed of connectivity.
Well, we don't actually have a target on connectivity. There is a definition of supervised broadband, which is 24 megabits per second. And what I certainly... and the target I'm trying to achieve is to get 100% access to superfast broadband for people in Scotland, and that's the one that we're aiming for, and obviously we can be judged on whether or not we're able to secure such a level of connectivity.
Thank you.
Okay, James.
Vera, good morning, Deputy First Minister. I've got a couple of questions around the broadband connection voucher scheme. I note that on the 3rd of September the government announced that over 40,000 vouchers have been issued in the UK, yet only 2,087 have been from Scotland. Given that the vouchers are issued on a first-come, first-served basis, do you have any idea why the uptake would be so low in Scotland, and what the government are doing to encourage Scottish businesses to take advantage of this scheme?
We've got a number of awareness-raising measures in place which are delivered through our work with BD UK, through the work of the Digital Scotland programme, through the work of CBS, to encourage more and more companies to take up superfast broadband. We obviously have to persistently take forward those steps to make sure that we raise full awareness about the opportunities and the possibilities because of the significant contribution this can make to business. And one of the steps that we take is through the wider work that we take forward on digital participation to encourage a greater understanding and awareness of the opportunities presented by digital connectivity. This is an area where we work closely also with our enterprise agencies and with the Business Gateway and with some of the new start business organisations like Entrepreneurial Spark and Scottish Edge to encourage companies to essentially consider immediately the importance of having digital connectivity and what that can provide for the for the ability to undertake well-connected business activities on behalf of companies within the marketplace.
And do you have a feel for why you think the uptake's been lower here than it has in the rest of the UK, I suspect.
I don't have any specific rationale for that. I can only talk anecdotally about the mood I detect within the New Start business community, for example, where they literally cannot get digital connectivity quick enough because it's seen as a major element of how they take forward their business activities and their business programme. So I can see the advantages are very clear to be seen and I think taken up by a range of organisations. But certainly what we do concentrate on is making sure that there is as wide an awareness as possible about the availability of the voucher scheme, and we look to public authorities and enterprise bodies and other agencies to make sure that awareness is raised with members of the public.
Clarify then, Deputy First Minister, the provisions you've outlined there are about trying to make sure that people are aware of the government scheme, but also incentivising them. Is there any other way you incentivise them to take partners?
I think that the key thing, I think, is about awareness raising, because one of the issues about digital participation from the business community perspective is that we have to more and more encourage the business community to think about how it takes forward its business operations through the medium of digital connectivity. And I think there is a tendency at times for organisations not to think about how they can adapt their business proposition to operate through a digital medium as opposed to the traditional way of operating that they may have. So I think awareness raising is the key thing we can do to try to encourage and to motivate more and more organisations to participate.
Okay, thank you.
Mike.
Thank you, Convener. I hope the Cabinet Secretary will forgive me if I go over some territory that you've actually already covered, but I think I'll learn to live with that, Convener, with your disapprobation. But I think these issues are really important, and you know, there's no harm in underlining them, so to speak. And first of all, I should say that I warmly welcome the expenditure the government's making with the fibre optic rollout. Nothing as an islander all my adult life, nothing transformed my life more than the coming of the internet, initial coming of the internet. Nothing I can think of in 36 years levelled the playing field between rural, remote rural life and urban life more than the coming of the internet. So I warmly welcome the expenditure. But the point I feel that's very important, because I've had numerous complaints from constituents now that Scottish Government have taken ownership of this to a degree in providing a solution, that I feel that constituents don't fully understand that actually this is a matter that's wholly reserved to Westminster. And you touched on this business of this, the preferred solution, and I can see the wisdom in that being a universal service obligation that's fit for purpose in the 21st century. Do you agree with me that ultimately would be the best way to tackle this?
I do, because it would put the onus on on BT to essentially provide the foundations of appropriate connectivity in the 21st century, appropriate and relevant connectivity in the 21st century. And I completely agree with Mr. McKenzie's analysis of the impact of this on rural Scotland. I mean, one of the points that I've made in countless speeches, and I apologise to the committee if any of you have had any of the members have had the misfortune to have heard this line of argument before, but I'll make it again because I think it's important. For the first time in history, the Highlands and Islands, in an economic downturn, has outperformed the rest of Scotland. And to me, that's because of digital connectivity, because in every economic downturn in the past, what the people of the Highlands and Islands have had to do to overcome economic difficulty is leave. And then we spend years trying to recover from the fact that people had to leave the Highlands and Islands and find economic opportunity elsewhere. Then we've had to try to recover it and restore it. And this has been going on, well, it's, you know, well, it's been going on probably all of my life since the visionary interventions of the establishment of the Highlands and Islands Development Board. And what digital connectivity does is it largely eliminates that disadvantage, because people have been able to stay in the Highlands and Islands, remain digitally connected, make their living in the Highlands and Islands, and be able to continue to contribute to their communities. Now, I'm not sure if Mr. I think Mr. McKenzie was in the chamber yesterday for my speech in the debate on the economy, but I was in the Western Isles at the weekend at the opening of Loch Boisdale Harbour, a project taken forward by Stora Suist, the community interest company in South Uist. And I had a discussion with stakeholders about what would be the key interventions that would make all the difference to the community. And I suppose two of them leapt out at me. One was digital connectivity, and the other, of course, was ferry connections, which are issues the government is currently addressing. But the digital connectivity point was so significant to everybody that I talked to in that stakeholder gathering about how they could continue to live in a magnificent part of the world, how they could pursue their educational opportunities in that magnificent part of the world, and trade from that magnificent part of the world, all because of digital connectivity. And so I think the point is absolutely central to how we tackle rural depopulation. And the area in which Mr. McKenzie lives is a part of the Highlands and Islands which is still suffering rural depopulation, but we have an opportunity, if we get this right, to start to stem the tide of that rural depopulation. It's about more things than digital connectivity, I readily concede, but this is one major contributor to how we can actually do that. And I think the task would be easier if we had the foundation of a universal service obligation, but in the absence of a universal service obligation, the type of constructive dialogue I am having with Ofcom is designed to make sure that we make as much progress to ensure that there is sufficient regulatory pressure applied to, in my view, deliver as much along the way to a universal service obligation as we possibly can do.
Thank you. Thank you very much. That's, I could not agree more with what you're saying, Cabinet Secretary. One aspect of difficulty appears to be the fact that BT, and I would pay a tribute to BT and HIE for the work they're doing across the Highlands and Islands. From my previous career, I know just how challenging some of that work can be. But one of the things that I've not been able to understand is why they're unable to tell us in some community areas whether or not they'll actually be able to provide the fibre optic connectivity that people want, and therefore who exactly, which communities exactly are going to be left in this remaining 5% that will have to be covered by community schemes. And just in passing, I would pay a huge tribute to the Mulling Iona Community Trust, who I think have led the way for the Argyle Community Broadband Project. But it seems to me, you know, fathomless as to why they're unable to tell us which areas as yet they will be unable to reach, to allow some of these communities who have fears they'll be left behind to start to get to grips with community broadband schemes. Are you able to shed any light on that?
First of all, can I actually, I'd like to just reiterate a point that Mr. McKenzie made, which is about paying tribute to what BT has actually managed to achieve. It's very easy to criticise BT in a whole number of respects, but there has been very effective rollout of the service. By the end of August, 86,940 premises in the Highlands and Islands had connectivity, and BT are on track to pass their quarter three 2015 target of 93,946 premises by the end of September. And these are very significant achievements given the terrain and the challenges. Nearly 300 cabinets have been established by June 2015, and over 800 kilometres of access cabling laid, and 400 kilometres of subsea cabling laid. Again, I was able to discuss with the grouping in South Uist on Saturday the fact that the mainstay cables that have been laid across the Minch to connect the Western Isles, and essentially a spine connection down the whole of the Western Isles has now been laid from which the feeds can be taken to roll out the services. So there has been a great deal achieved, and I also want to put on record my appreciation of the work of Highlands Islands Enterprise, who have driven this project very aggressively as one of their key interventions to support economic development in the Highlands and Islands, and it has been very well led by the team at Highlands and Islands Enterprise. I suppose Mr. McKenzie's question is the $64 million question, to be honest, because it's the one to which everyone's waiting for an answer. As I rehearsed to the convener earlier on, if BT is going to go somewhere with the provision of fibre broadband, we then cannot justify a non-BT programme solution to go in there. We can't do it. It's against state aid rules. So it would help if we had greater clarity about what are the areas that BT are unlikely to go to. And that is difficult to define, because BT also have me on their back saying, I want that 95% up at 96 or 97%. So it's not all an issue that can be attributed to BT, because I'm trying to maximise, and Parliament would not be surprised that I'm trying to maximise the effectiveness of the £410 million that we have invested, because if we do that, it minimises what else I've got to put into the pot to try to deliver connectivity across the board. Now, I think there are likely to be some more obvious areas where BT are unlikely to go. And therefore, I think there are probably more examples that could be shared with us about how there are limitations to what is going to be the reach of the BT programme, and how we could then respond accordingly to put in place some of the early preparation of community-based solutions which would meet the needs of individuals and communities.
Thank you, Secretary. If I could turn now to smartphones, which again I appreciate, you know, as an area of telecommunications that's fully reserved, that it seems to me part of the way that these services in general are designed to operate is to integrate with each other. And yet, my perception on the ground is that, in spite of very helpfully provided us with a pretty comprehensive briefing, a lot of the data is derived from the latest Ofcom data, and yet I don't recognise that data. As a frequent traveller across the Highlands and Islands living there, this device works superbly and seamlessly here in Edinburgh, integrates with the fixed line provision and so on, and I now have an effective and efficient method of working here in Edinburgh, but it's not by no means a level playing field, even in terms of the data, in as much as I don't recognise the maps, I don't recognise the connectivity, so that if I could perhaps explain it, that 3G, for instance, is not what it was a year ago, where it was, because I think it's greater usage. So what used to be perfectly acceptable 3G coverage in certain areas now no longer functions well, in fact functions less well than 2G did 2 or 3 years ago. And I just wonder, is there anything, you know, the fibre optic intervention, the community broadband is superb, you know, and a terrific intervention. Is there anything the Scottish Government can do to influence the mobile connectivity situation also?
This is, again, a significant issue. I think I've two devices, an iPad and a smartphone, and they're from different networks. So I feel as if I've got a pretty good understanding of where you can secure connectivity around the country, because Mr. McKenzie will appreciate I'm on the road a fair amount into the bargain, and I can sympathise with his point about the relevance of the maps. I think I could certainly. I was utterly conversant with every moment you can get a 3G signal between Parliament and my house in Perthshire, every single moment, and I choose my moments to access the system given my knowledge of that connectivity, which was pretty intermittent, to be honest. I have to say I'm seeing an improvement on that journey, so I now have more. The connectivity is improving. Much to my surprise, my delight, actually, I was sitting in a cafe in Aileth in my own constituency and happened to look at my smartphone to realise that I had a 4G signal, and this may have explained why I'd had numerous complaints from constituents about the intermittence of the mobile network for a few days beforehand, but it was obviously the upgrade being undertaken. So there's clearly improvements being made in the mobile connections, but I don't think the maps that Mr. McKenzie refers to, the level of connectivity, really does reflect the real world of people's experience. What I've done on this is I've invited the four mobile network operators to meet with me, and we met some weeks ago. I'm just trying to think, time is passing so quickly. Was it July?
It was July.
To basically open up a discussion about accepting that the regulatory issues are not mine to resolve, because they're not, how we could, by collaborative work, try to improve mobile connectivity within Scotland. And I think really three things are relevant in that respect. The first is that the mobile operators are increasingly seeing the mobile infrastructure as having a relevance to the fibre infrastructure, and there is now a much greater connection between those two, much greater proximity between the two. And of course there are company acquisitions and transactions that will make some of that ever closer as a consequence of transactions that are underway. So that's the first point. The second is that I was keen to identify practical ways in which the Scottish Government and other authorities that we work with could try to help to improve mobile connectivity. And one of the issues comes down to literally the height of masts. And as members of Parliament, we will all be familiar with the sensitivities around issues around masts and deployment. So for me, I think we have a duty, if members of the public are complaining about poor connectivity, to actually try to help the mobile companies find some of the solutions by addressing some of the mast issues and saying to constituents and communities, look, if you want better connectivity, maybe putting in fewer objections to masts might help getting that connectivity. Not an easy message to sell, I concede, but I'll maybe leave that to Mr. Johnson to convey on my behalf. But that's some of the debate we've got to have. So we're going through a process of looking at what are the practical steps we can take in that respect. And then thirdly, is to encourage the mobile operators to maximise the cooperation between themselves. And they were anxious to assure me that they do have cooperation around the sharing of masts and the sharing of infrastructure. But I have encouraged them to go away and to reflect further on that. And we're going to have, you know, we set out this agenda, which will be about the government and public authorities looking at how we can take steps within our existing competence, whether it's around planning or the regulatory regime that we control, or about some issues around business rates, how we can advance some of those questions to help out to improve the rollout. And the companies are going away to try to see what, how better they can work together. And we're going to reconvene in about 3 months' time to take stock about how much progress we've made in this respect. And I'm personally going to chair those discussions and drive them to make sure that we make more progress on this question. Because, you know, we live in a world, you know, I was, I travelled from Oban to Lough Boisdale on Saturday morning, and if there had been an issue with the ferry service, which there was not, it was a magnificent ferry service and ferry crossing, I might have wanted to access the CalMac app on my phone. Well, I couldn't have done it on the street in Oban, because I didn't have any appropriate connectivity to enable me to do so. So, and if people are coming to visit our country from cities around the world where, you know, 4G is like, you know, yesterday's technology, and they suddenly decide to share with us the beauty and the majesty of a CalMac ferry trip from Oban to Lough Boisdale, they'll have a challenge of connectivity on the main street in Oban.
Final question, Cabinet Secretary, is if you... I just wonder if you agree with me that a lot of the other... This is perhaps, you know, important in other public policy areas and public policy difficulties in the Highlands and Islands. For instance, if we're going to advance telemedicine in the most rural areas, and if we're going to deal with the issues in attracting rural GPs and rural teachers, part of that problem, I think, at least, is the perception that rural parts of Scotland are backwaters, and that one way, at least, of addressing that is to give to end this inequality of connectivity. And so there are areas that are perhaps don't spring foremost to mind of public policy difficulties that can be eased and helped by good connectivity.
I think it's central, and it's not only central to the issues around rural connectivity, it's central to the management of the public finance challenge that we all face, whether it's in urban or rural Scotland. So, for example, there is some excellent work underway in health and social care about very efficient integrated assessments of individuals that are undertaken by members of the staff who are out there in the field, and they're feeding back their information and the data they're gathering and all the rest of it through smartphone devices. Some tremendous work going on. Well, that's fabulous if you've got connectivity. Now, when you look at, and some of that can be a challenge in urban Scotland as well, I accept that, but there will be occasions where we can meet some of the challenges of rural service provision by having access to really high quality digital connectivity that enables staff out in the field to do their job, to fulfil their requirements, and to be able to feed that information back into the system and to interact in a way that really supports the needs of vulnerable individuals in our communities. So that is one crucial application. Another is about educational access. You know, I was recently at Murray College in Elgin, and I was delivering a speech in a lecture theatre, and the principal of the college told me that prior to my contribution, there was a lecture delivered there which went to 40 locations digitally. So people are able to get access to quality interaction and education from 40 locations around the Highlands and Islands, from one place in Elgin, and nobody has had to go very far. Well, some people might have had to go far even to get to that digital point, but they've not had to leave an island community or travel long distances. And crucially, that enables people to remain within their localities and to make
a significant economic contribution as a consequence.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. That's very helpful. No further questions, convener.
Thank you. Alex.
Thank you. Just to refer back to the Minister's previous comment, I do have to note that 15 years ago, the most common thing in my mailbag were people complaining that they believed they were going to suffer physical damage as a result of mobile phone masts. And today, the biggest thing I get in my mailbag is people complaining about poor mobile phone signals. So I think we've gone through a change there, and we can perhaps drive that on. Just another observation. I heard the other day that it was on Radio 4, so it must be true, that you can get a 4G mobile signal on the summit of Mount Everest. And now you tell me you can get one in Aileth as well. Are we at a point where we actually have to reconsider our priorities and perhaps look at using the mobile infrastructure which is developing rather than carry on with the relentless quest to get a physical connection to every property?
Well, I think this is in some ways fits into the issue about finding the right solution for all properties. We are a product of our history as a society, and we're a society that has been, our connectivity has been built around the rollout of cables to all properties. And that is fundamentally what underpins our infrastructure. But one of the interesting points in my discussion with the mobile network operators, it's one of the points I made in my response to Mr. McKenzie, is that it was very clear to me that they view the delivery of a mobile solution or the delivery of a fixed line solution as part of the same consideration. So it may well be that we get to the point where for some users in the country, actually a mobile solution is infinitely more practical and infinitely more affordable and infinitely more sustainable than, and probably infinitely more future-proofed than a fixed-line solution. So it will be, there will be a need, and that's part of the iterative process we have to go through to meet my objective of making sure every individual is properly supported by digital connectivity and having access to digital connectivity. Because some of those individuals in remote areas may well find that the solution lies in an affordable broadband solution.
Thank you.
Okay, Adam.
Thanks, convener. You touched on the importance of digital inclusion earlier on in your remarks. We've recently seen the UK government coming up with a digital inclusion outcomes framework. So will the Scottish Government be using this framework, or do you intend to benchmark progress yourselves?
We're having a look at that framework to see if it would be the most appropriate and suitable for us to take forward, and that issue is currently being examined by government, and obviously once we get further down the road of that analysis, I'm very happy to share the conclusions with the committee. Okay.
So apart from the physical infrastructure investment that's going on, what other areas would you regard as very important in terms of promoting digital inclusion?
I think the first thing to say is that we've generally had... there's been, a general sense over the years that Scotland lagged behind in digital participation. And I've always been pretty sceptical about those numbers. I've never really believed them. And recently we had data that showed that about 82% of the population were using the internet for personal use, which I think rather more closely relates to what I would have thought would have been the position. So I think we're now seeing, and interesting, I was up in Ullapool, the Cabinet was meeting in Ullapool a few weeks ago, and I observed a marvellous project that takes place in the library in Ullapool, where older members of the community can come in to meet up with teenagers who sit with them with their iPads and their smartphones and explain to them what to do. And in every respect, it was just a marvellous thing to observe, apart from the atmosphere of mutual respect between older people and younger people and younger people and older people. There was a genuine appreciation amongst the older people that were there that these young folk were helping them to get access to the modern world. And it was, there's measures like that which will be, we shouldn't understate the significance of what that can contribute to enabling everybody to be participants. Because if we then go down the route, as I was talking about with Mr. McKenzie, of seeing many of our public services delivered through in a digital context, then we need to have everybody able to access this technology and to be able to do it in a fashion that that meets the needs of all citizens. So our participation efforts are designed to ensure that, as well as the physical connections that are in place, that also within our society, more and more people of different backgrounds are able to contribute to this process.
So it goes hand in hand with our efforts to tackle social exclusion.
Yes, yes. And also, there's also relevance in terms of some of the wider agenda around about ensuring that public services meet the needs of individuals. You know, having apps on a smartphone which enable people to monitor their health condition or their taking of prescribed medicines or even their exercise regime are all really powerful elements of what can be delivered to meet the needs of individuals. So I'm very committed to making sure that we improve and increase awareness and encourage the maximisation of participation within this area of activity by all elements of society.
Okay. On a slightly different tack, but related, what can the Scottish Government do to help employees of small and medium enterprises to achieve the necessary digital skills to push forward their business? As you point out, this technology is developing all the time and the skills are required.
We're just embarking, we've just launched a new digital skills academy called Code Clan, which is a partnership with the private sector. And this is one of the measures that we are putting in place to ensure that there is the ability to generate the skills pipeline that we require within the country. Obviously, there's a very significant obligation on our further education and higher education institutions to be able to contribute in this process, as well as the school sector. And we have to make sure that the type of support that's available actually meets the needs of the emerging marketplace. And we will continue to review this because, as I said in the Chamber yesterday in response to an intervention from Mary Scanlon, that I very rarely go through a discussion with the business community just now without, or for some considerable time, without digital skills being raised as a significant issue.
Thank you.
Deputy First Minister, can I ask you about the international dimension and perhaps ask you to reflect on what lessons Scotland can learn from the rollout of broadband infrastructure in other European countries, in particular countries that have similar geography in terms of remoteness to Scotland?
The key thing that I would say is that we have to have a very focused programme for the delivery of this infrastructure, and that I'm satisfied that we have got that, but I could see how it could be easier for us if we had the type of regulatory environment that I talked about earlier on in my answers. That would make it a great deal easier to pursue this objective, and it would make it a great deal more focused. I think there is good focus in the programme now. There is impetus behind the programme. There is the necessary drive to deliver it. Comparatively speaking, our programme is very ambitious in world terms, and you always get very worried when civil servants tell you your programme is very ambitious. It's always a moment to be nervous about what you're actually doing, but we do have, in comparative terms, a very ambitious programme. But I think the lessons I would learn, that I would take from it, are about ensuring that we have a real drive and focus around how we can deploy these interventions.
Okay. Is this something that you or your officials have looked at in terms of what other smaller European countries' approach has been to the issue of rollout of broadband?
It is, and it's part of the work that is underway to support the development of the world-class programme that we are looking at as to how we can ensure that all of what we are doing is equipping Scotland with some real strategic advantages and benefits for the years to come.
Okay. The European Commission has identified the completion of the digital single market as one of its own 10 political priorities and launched a digital single market strategy earlier this year, which includes a series of initiatives to be delivered by the end of 2016. So can I ask you, what are the implications of the digital single market for Scotland, and what work is the Scottish Government doing to ensure that the benefits from this are available, particularly in terms of better access for consumers and businesses to digital goods and services across that digital single market?
This is a fundamental opportunity right across the board within Scotland, and what we aim to do is to ensure that we seize the opportunity that emerges for businesses and consumers alike. It is very clear to me that, and I used this illustration earlier on, that many of the new start companies in Scotland, if I go back 25 years to when I was working in the business development sector in Scotland, one of the early things that we would suggest a company that was trying to embark on market development was to print a brochure. And, well, you know, 25 years on, you know, nice to have, but it's not going to get the type of presence in the marketplace that digital connectivity can deliver for companies. And I'm very struck by, in the New Start business community, the extent to which people think once they've got their smartphone, that's them off. They're international traders. The world is their oyster because they've got that connectivity. So we have to make sure we've got the infrastructure that can fit into what is an increasingly digitised marketplace, and the European digital, the digital single market is an illustration of that. So our infrastructure commitment will be important in supporting access in that respect. Our inclusion support to ensure that we've got people able to participate in the single market. And crucially, our dialogue with Ofcom is important, ensuring that the interests that we have and the concerns that we have about the digital single market are properly and fully advanced by the United Kingdom government as the member state who will be involved in these discussions on our behalf.
Is there any direct dialogue and discussion between the Scottish Government ministers and officials and the European Commission on this, or is it all directed through the member state in London?
We obviously maintain dialogue with the European Commission on all questions, but the primary dialogue in this area is undertaken through the United Kingdom government.
Okay, and you mentioned world-class connectivity. Are you in a position to provide us with a status update on where that work is at?
The work that we're undertaking here has been taken forward by the Scottish Futures Trust. They're involved in a great deal of dialogue around the with industry and with the public sector to identify how we can create, essentially, I suppose, at the heart of what SFT do for us. They draw together different players and identify how we can maximise investment as a consequence of collaboration. And that work is underway, and I'm awaiting further feedback from SFT about these questions. We've got some progress in relation to projects such as the Isle of Col project that I mentioned, the some trials in partnership with Strathclyde University, and some support to the SME community around Edinburgh University. But we hope to have some further work identified to be taken forward beyond March of next year, and which will be informed by our contribution to the Infrastructure Investment Plan, which will be published before, alongside the budget.
Thank you. Do members have any other questions for the Deputy First Minister? In that case, can I thank you, Deputy First Minister, and your officials for appearing before the committee this morning, but also thank you for your leadership in this area of digital connectivity and participation and the rollout of superfast broadband across Scotland more generally. So thank you very much indeed. We look forward to further updates in the future. I'll now suspend our meeting briefly to allow the witnesses to leave the room. Thank you.